Now, a look at the plain speech and droll wit of one of the United States' foremost poets. Jeffrey Brown has our book conversation.
The trouble with poetry is that it encourages the writing of more poetry, more guppies crowding the fish tank. Lines from Billy Collins, former poet laureate and one of the nation's best-known poets. His new collection is titled Aimless Love, New and Selected Poems from His Work of the Last Decade. And welcome to you.
Thank you very much, Jeff.
I thought I would steal from a blurb in this book. Alice Fulton writes, Billy Collins puts the fun back in profundity. Are you consciously aiming for fun? Are you consciously aiming for profundity? What are you doing?
Well, there's a lot of unconscious activity that goes on, I think, in the composition of a poem. So I can't picture myself starting out aiming to do anything or having much of an agenda. I think in writing a poem, I'm making some tonal adjustments. And it took me a long time to allow anything like fun into my poetry.
It did?
Yeah, well, I thought originally when I was in school and I wanted to be a poet, I knew that poets seemed to be miserable. And I was a pretty happy kid, but I was willing to...
So you had to fit yourself into that miserableness.
I had to fake it. I had to get into this miserable character before I wrote poems. And it wasn't for quite a while that I was able to read poets that were... allowed me to be humorous without being silly.
But humorous as a, that's hard to do too, right? To try to be humorous.
Well, it is. I mean, the really authentic thing about humor is that anyone can pretend to be serious. Anyone who's ever had a job, in fact, we're pretending to be serious now, more or less. or if you've sat in the classroom, you can put on seriousness.
Right.
But you can't pretend to be funny.
Right.
I mean, you can fail to be funny,
but
you can't fake it.
But the authenticity of the voice that you developed, is developed the right word? I mean, it took time to get that voice, which is a kind of, there is humor, but it is a casual voice, I guess. Is that
well, it's,
fair?
Yeah, it's. I think it starts out with a casual, straightforward tone, trying to just get the reader engaged in the first stanza by not making too many demands on the reader, by just setting up a little scene or a kind of engagement of speech. I hope the poem, as it goes on, gets more complicated, a little more demanding, a little more ambiguous or speculative, so that we're drifting away from the casual beginning of the poem into something a little more serious.
All right, I want you to read the first of the new poems, just as an example here. It's called The Sandhill Cranes of Nebraska.
Okay.
Okay?
You're quite right about the title. The Sandhill Cranes of Nebraska. Too bad you weren't here 6 months ago, was a lament I heard on my visit to Nebraska. You could have seen the astonishing spectacle of the sandhill cranes, thousands of them, feeding and even dancing on the shores of the Platte River. There was no point in pointing out the impossibility of my being there then because I happened to be somewhere else. So I nodded and put on a look of mild disappointment, if only to be part of the commiseration. It was the same look I remember wearing about 6 months ago in Georgia when I was told that I had just missed the spectacular annual outburst of azaleas, brilliant against the green backdrop of spring. And the same in Vermont 6 months before that, when I arrived shortly after the magnificent foliage had gloriously peaked, Mother Nature, as she is called, having touched the hills with her many-colored brush, a phenomenon that occurs, like the others, around the same time every year, when I am apparently off in another state, stuck in a motel lobby with the local paper and a styrofoam cup of coffee, busily missing God knows what.
So there's the humor of always being in the wrong place at the wrong time, but also the, if it is profundity, of that's life, right?
Well, it is, and it's Howard Nemiroff who made up the verb to azaleate. To azaleate someone means to commiserate with them about some local natural event that they just missed, or they will miss because they're leaving too early.
You do a lot of public readings and a lot of public speaking, and one of a handful of poets who I guess we could think of as public poets in our culture, which is not noticeably open to poetry all that much, right? What's your sense of it?
Well, you know, Robert Frost really started this whole thing rolling. He was, I believe, the first poet who started going to colleges. Before that, poets didn't give public readings very often. Mm-hmm. Certainly not, there was no circuit of schools. Well, now, I would say at any given moment in American life, there are probably 45 poets in airplanes vectoring across the country heading towards...
I mean, it's a funny image for when we usually think nobody's reading poetry, but you're saying poets are crisscrossing America.
I mean, I don't know if anyone's reading it, but the poets are still flying around the country going from lectern to lectern. That circuitry has become very well established.
Let me ask you finally, I noticed in some of the more recent work, you're working more in poetic forms. Sonnets, even a play on haiku in one area. Yeah. Well, is there a reason for that? Is it the challenge or just wanting the form?
Well, I think the pleasure of form is that you have a companion with you besides all the poets you've ever read. Mm-hmm. You have the form, which
you're
actually...
You're always aware of those poets you've ever read?
I think the candles of the page are lit by those poets of the past. To write poetry is to be very alone, but you always have the company of your influences. But you also have the company of the form itself, which has a kind of consciousness. I mean, the sonnet will simply tell you that's too many syllables, or that's too many lines, or that's the wrong place. Mm-hmm. So instead of being alone, you're in dialogue with the form.
As opposed to you have to telling yourself, Billy, maybe enough.
That's right. Right.
All right, the new collection is Aimless Love, New and Selected Poems. Billy Collins, thanks so much.
Great to be here.